Hospital Porter's pride and dignity, stop the new world order. Welcome to Panwo TV. Well, I'm going to the cinema again. As you may, regular viewers will probably recognise this area now because it's the little road leading to the cinema. Yes, this is another of those roving film reviews, so if you don't like them, just to let you know, that's what this is going to be. Now, today I'm glad to say I'm going at a more reasonable time. I'm actually going to... the sun's out, it's daylight. Yes, it's about 2:30 in the afternoon. And I've finished work for the day, so a bit early. So I'm going to go to the cinema and see a film. To tell you all about it, like I did before, while we're sort of on the road, I've got my... it's not a film about Australia, even though I've got my Australia hat on again. The one that everyone thought was the St. Helena flag. It's possible to get a hat with a St. Helena flag. I'll look into that. So I'd like to get a hat with the St. Helena flag on it. Anyway, I'm digressing again. I'm going along here and I'm going to go and see this film. Now, the film I'm going to see is called The Viceroy's House. I sort of saw the trailer and I thought I'd go and see it. I just felt like one of these subconscious urges to go and see it. You may think it's actually an historical drama set in 1940s India. I suppose the first thing you might think, well, if you've seen it yourself or you've seen the trailer, well, saw the titles of this video, is, well, what's, there's nothing very Panwo-y about this film, is there? It's not like, of course, when it came to, you know, the Resident Evil film or The Denial or the other film reviews I've done, yes, there is a Panwo-y element to that. But what's Panwo-y about a historical film about 1940s India? Well, what I found, generally, as I go through life, is you can actually find Panwo-y things almost everywhere. And I've found Panwo-y things in the most unlikely places. And I just feel a very strong subconscious urge to go and see this film. I mean, I'll let you know after. So I'm going to go and see it now. Decision's made. I'm going to go and watch it, so we'll see how it goes. Anyway, the film... is The Viceroy's House. Now, this is may not make be confused with another film. It may be similar to another film I've already seen. A film that was made quite a while ago, actually. I think it's a film made in the 60s or 70s called The Last Viceroy. I think that had George C. Scott in it. But this is a different film. It's a film that came out that's just been released. Obviously, it's in the flick, so it's just been released. But... It tells a story, as the last Viceroy did, of the end of British colonial rule in India, which was called the Raj. The Raj means a kingdom in the language, but it referred specifically to the British colonial rule of India, which lasted for several centuries. Started with the India Company in the 18th century, ended, I think, in the late 1940s, just after World War II. And India got home rule, they became independent. Originally, I think they were a Commonwealth nation, then they broke from the Commonwealth, I'm not sure. I think I'll have to look into that. I know that other countries went two stages. I know Ireland went two stages. They started as became independent in 1921, left the Commonwealth in 1949, or 1949, I think. Going under this railway bridge again, when my voice goes funny. Now, a viceroy is literally, he's a ruler of a colony, of a colonial subject state. I mean, literally, the man who acts in place of the king. And I suppose the equivalent in today's world would be a governor general in a Commonwealth country. All Commonwealth countries have a governor general who represents the king or queen in that Commonwealth. So even though the country itself has an independent government, it has head of state, it's still the queen. The governor general represents the queen. Canada, Australia, several other countries in the British Commonwealth have that. Now, a viceroy actually governs the colonial subject. He's actually in charge of the entire country and acts for the government, which is appointed by the imperial ruler. And Lord Louis Mountbatten, I believe, was the last viceroy. There's the Oxford Science Park down there. That's a weird place, I'll tell you. And this little brook has started smelling of sewage again. I just thought they cleaned it up. It's starting to smell like poo again. That's a film I'm going to see. It stars Gillian Anderson and Michael Gambon, who I didn't realise was still alive. He is, apparently. Oh, he's in Harry Potter, that's right. It's the other guy who died. Edward, what's his name? Edward Harris, he died. The guy who played Dumbledore before. Who else is it? Hugh Bonneville is in it as well. So it's quite a star-studded cast. Gillian Anderson, best known for being Scully in... I think she's from Ireland, actually. But she best plays Scully in The X-Files, which, of course, I'm a big fan of, as you probably guessed, judging by the things I talk about. Yes, that's right. That's right, Nick Pope. Yes, you can use that against me. Okay, we're going down this pathway again. Let's see if I can find my way through in daylight. I couldn't find my way through here last time because it was dark. Because I went to the midnight special to see Resident Evil. I'm going at a sensible time of day now. I don't know what this film's going to be like. It could be... you see, it's always politically contentious because it's about the end of empire. It came at a time when the British Empire was basically imploding. And India was probably the biggest. It was the jewel in the crown, to quote the Paul Scott novels, and the TV series came from it. But basically, India was the most important of Britain's overseas subjects. The biggest, it's huge, one of the most populous countries on earth, I think. Still is to this day. I mean, it's one out of every six people in the world lives in India. And I think it was the same back then. Well, the world population was lower, but it was the same proportions. And this is why it's so disturbing when the Indian government say they're going to bring national ID cards in. Sorry, I'm digressing. Right, the film. I hope it's not going to be. I'm going to see this blindfolded. I've not read any reviews. I've not asked anyone who's seen it for their opinion. I just don't want to know about it. I'm seeing it as a completely new viewer. I've just seen the trailer, thought it was worth going to see, had this urge to go and see it. Now, what I hope it's not going to be is propaganda. By that I mean, these horrible, evil white people, you know, how nasty they were to those sweet little Indians, and they did nothing, but they were evil oppressors, and the British Empire was just a bunch of evil, white, straight males who cackled demonically and rubbed their hands, going, as they trampled over the bodies of the poor brown... people from around the world, who's sweet little things who've never hurt a fly. I mean, I hope it's not going to be like that. Of course, as far as historical, from a historical revisionist perspective, of course, you know, this is always a possibility because there's so much. I mean, I've talked before about cultural Marxism, about how much cultural Marxist propaganda there is on TV and in the cinemas, and on the big screen and the small screen. And I hope this is not going to be one of those. Now, don't get me wrong, okay? I know it's not black and white either way. And if I lived in the 1940s, I kid you not, I would definitely have supported Home Rule for India. I definitely would have. I would have been on the side of Gandhi and Nehru and all the others. I like the idea of nations being independent. I don't I don't think... I feel the same way about India being independent from the British Empire, the same way I feel about Britain being independent from the European Union, which I regard as an evil, oppressive empire. And Britain is a subject nation of that empire. I've talked about this. See my videos I made about Brexit. I made three all about the European Union referendum. That being said, I mean, it's... You know, the British Empire was not some kind of evil, demonic, global hegemony. It was, I think it was designed to turn into one, because I think it was the fledgling of the New World Order. But in terms of its, what happened is, it emerged partly as a voluntary action by the people who joined it. So there were many people who actually did. Many people in the supposed conquered nations who actually wanted to be part of the British Empire. The same way, and I'm not going to have a Boudicca moment, all right, the same way that some of the tribes in Britain, when the Romans came along, when the Romans invaded, actually were not conquered as much as they simply joined. It was the rubber stamping of a situation that already existed because they were already culturally and economically Romanized anyway. And the same goes for the British Empire. And of course, another thing that the social justice warriors will say, you know, they'll go, evil white heterosexual males, aren't they? They're nasty, they're scum. They created slavery and they had slavery and the British Empire was built on slavery. Ah! Yeah, the British Empire was built on slavery, sadly, much to the discredit of it. And all the other societies on Earth that were also using slaves, including in India. In fact, there were more slaves in India than there were before the British Empire, and as there were afterwards. And in fact, today, they're still slaves. There's more slaves than ever, and they're in India. Most of them are in India. And the fact of the matter is, it was, yes, the British Empire was built on slavery, but the British Empire was also the first place on Earth that actually enforced the 1805 abolition of slavery resolution, Britain was a signatory to it, and Britain was the first nation that actually adopted it. Actually abolished slavery throughout the British Empire. So again, there's always two sides looking at every story. And it concerns me, I think about it is that the evil, I'm not a nationalist, I'm not a flag waver, but the evil, nasty, white, heterosexual, male, British patriot motif, the meme, is actually being used to justify the very dictatorial global superstate that the people who claim to be in favour of freedom are against. That's the irony of it. That is the essence of what cultural Marxism is. So, I hope it's good. I'm going to move on, actually. It's starting, so I'm just going to go down here towards the... I did enjoy David Lean's film Gandhi, the one with Ben Kingsley plays Gandhi. That was good. And, of course, since then, of course, you go... You look into it behind. There was all kinds of other stories about Gandhi. Gandhi wasn't an angel. Yeah, no, sure he wasn't. I mean, this is the thing. You have people like Winston Churchill and Nelson Mandela and Mother Teresa, Gandhi. They're all sort of like angelic beings. Whereas you get Genghis Khan and Hitler and Stalin on the other side who were monsters. History has a habit of turning quite mortal and quite fallible and complex human beings into demons and angels. I found that. But I did enjoy David Lean's Gandhi. That was a good movie. That was very good. What I'll do is I'll go and see the film. I'll come out. I'll tell you what I think of it. And then we'll go home and I'll just look at what the critics have to say about it. The fucking critics. Fucking bastards. Scum. Are there any critics watching this? You scum. You really are. You don't tell me what I can and can't think. Don't tell me what opinions I can and can't have. You, honestly, you're filth, critics. Sorry, I lost control of myself there for a minute talking about critics. We'll see what these people, in inverted quote unquote people, that's the kindest thing you can say about the critics. We'll see what they have to say about it. But in the meantime, I'm almost at the cinema now, so I'm going to switch off the camera and we're going to go in. So there's Oxford United Stadium, the Kassam Stadium, and the cinema is just down here, and I think I've come the right way. There's that wooden fence I couldn't get past the other night when it was really late. and there is the View Cinema. So, see you later.
Oh, one more thing, just to be transgressive, I'm filming inside the cinema. They tell you you're not allowed to do that, so I'm doing it just for the hell of it. But I'm actually filming inside the toilet, so I don't know if that counts. See here. I mean, they say you're not allowed to film in the cinema. I'm not going to film in the auditorium, but, well, I like to interpret things loosely, you know. So I know my rights.
Right, unfortunately you're not going to see the trailer right now. I know that's when this is the part of the film when you normally would show I normally would show you the trailer and you'd be able to watch that while I was in the cinema watching the movie. Unfortunately you can't this time. For reasons that I describe in my last video, more copyright trouble, I actually uploaded the video. The video you're seeing now is a new version of a video I uploaded on Wednesday night. The video was immediately flagged, as I explained in the previous video, and blocked in most of the countries in the world. Now, as I explained in More Copyright Trouble, I had the option of filing a dispute, which I probably would have won, as I am with the Dr. Jonathan Reed video, and then wait for 30 days where most of the people in the world couldn't see it, or what I'm doing now, which is to take the video down and simply re-edit it with a trailer out. This is what I've done, and as I explained in the previous video, I think it's silly. But no trailer, I'm afraid. But if you want to watch the trailer, you can. It's very simple. You just go to the link in the description box, as per Hopanwo TV tradition, and you will see the IMDb page. There's a link there, and that has links to all the trailers. And as I said in the previous video, you know, this is just daft. It's just crazy. And I'm going to go through some of your comments now. Thanks for all your comments. People have left comments on the previous video. That is the one more copyright trouble. And I'm just going to go through a few of them. I have replied to a few in the comments box myself in a written form, but I'm now going to comment. I'm now going to comment on any that I haven't tackled before. I'm going to comment now. Okay, in this video. So now I want to thank Factory Communications Limited, who gave me a lot of information, asking me, is it just music or script copyright? And I'm not sure what that means. I think you're an expert on this sort of thing, but it was the trailer of the movie, as I explained. I included the trailer in the movie, which I've done many times before, and there's never been a problem with it before, with anything else. Factory Communication Limited then went on to say, you cannot use it unless you have permission. Even in fair use, you do not own the trailer and your YouTube site does not look like the YouTube site they want to be associated with. The film has distribution on all film trailers and they're going to show. Right, well, the thing about it is, I think I should address this, even though I did reply to FCL in the comments section. This is not only, I think, untrue, and I think under fair use provisions in the copyright law, I can show the trailer, and I don't need their permission to do so. And it doesn't matter whether they want to be associated with my channel or not. It's a simple case of the law. Now, I know I'm going to say more. James Cox has made a few comments. I'm going to tackle those in a minute. But as far as I can see right now, that's the way the law stands. And FCL says, it's not worth the hassle. Yeah, it is tempting in a sense. I mean, I think the problem was, I think there's a principle at stake here. You know, I think it is, I don't believe I've done anything wrong. And I'm a bit of a stubborn bastard when it comes to things like this, I'm afraid, FCL. I know it's easy to just, as it is with the Reed video, I could just easily delete the video. Then I've got a copy of it somewhere. I could simply re-edit it. But I don't like it when someone just comes along, sticks a flag on there, and decides, oh, by the way, yeah, we're just going to stick a flag on there, yeah. And your video's banned in all the countries in the world. In the case of this particular one, the Viceroy's House video, it was banned in almost all the countries in the world. The Reed video was blocked in all countries in the world. So it's effectively the same as taking it down. Apart from the fact I don't get a copyright strike. They also said that, FCL made the point, they're blocking it and not removing it, so the owner can view to see if they want to go further. Crooks. Well, I'm now in the process of disputing that claim anyway. Oh, by the way, I find out who TVB were. Now, TVB, the people who actually put in the complaint,
about the Reed video. This little tiny 1.5 minute segment where Dr. Reed shows the alien video, the video he made in 1996 with the alien in, okay? Where he's paffing and panting like that, okay? You get it every... It's available in many other places online, on YouTube. TVBR, I had a look up... I couldn't find them at first. They are a rather obscure TV station from Hong Kong, China. Which is very strange. They're a Chinese language, Hong Kong-based TV station. So why are they flagging this video with Dr. Jonathan Reed's video in? I mean, has Dr. Jonathan Reed sold the rights of that alien video to TVB? That's the only solution I can think of. I haven't been in touch with Dr. Jonathan Reed since 2014 when he appeared at Rendlesham Forest. As I said, he didn't reply to any of my emails. I tried to contact him. We were going to edit another version of the video. He never wrote back to me. If he sold the rights of the video, or leased the rights of the video to TVB, fair enough, he can do that. He's the copyright owner. But even then, TVB can't go around just putting flags on videos because I'm using it under fair use provisions. When I'm actually using the video, the segment they're talking about is included in my video under Section 58 of the Copyright Designs and Patents Act of 1988. There are exceptions to that to the provision, and Reed and TVB do not fulfil any of those exceptions. I know because I've been through this before. I went through this in 2015 with bloody that Colonel Holt video. Okay. So that's why I'm doing it. And Xylemat Outland, I've replied to you already, but thanks. Xylemat Outland was very supportive, so thanks, Xylemat. He's a good guy, Xylemat. He comments on all my videos. Doffler Aspie has, of course, commented. here we go. YouTube artificial intelligence has become so anal, Ben. Yeah, I know what you mean. I think... this must be at least a semi-automated system to do something like this. It's possible that it was done simply by mistake. It's possible that somehow whatever algorithm TVB are using in their YouTube piracy detection system, it has wrongly flagged the Dr. Jonathan Reed video. In which case, this will be it'll be a very quick open and shut case. Doffler Aspect also says, Ben, you can't even post singing happy birthday. That's mad. That's true, actually. I mean, happy birthday is still under copyright. Here we go. Funnily enough, right, this is actually true. Happy birthday to you is a song, it's the most widely sung song in the world, according to the 1998 Guinness Book of Records. I remember seeing this on The Record Breakers, a TV show it was on when I was a kid. It says, traditionally, I'm on the Wikipedia page, traditionally attributed to the American sisters Patty and Mildred J. Hill in 1893. Although the claim that the sisters composed the tune is disputed. Right, well, it just sounds weird, doesn't it, that this song that is sung by everybody every day of the year and sung to you at least one day of every year by somebody should be copyrighted. That is extremely anal. That is anal. It's taking it up the arse with half a packet of sand, to be blunt. So yeah, it's pathetic. Anyway, right. Mark Porrett has said this. I don't really know why you are bothering with film reviews anyway. There are so many other more important things out there to get your teeth into, Ben. This side project of yours just seems to be causing you problems. Besides, I thought this was a channel... This channel was more conspiracies, UFO, paranormal. Okay. Right, thanks, Mark. He's written quite a long comment here. I'll go through it all. Now, the film reviews are a part of what I do. I mean, I think I know what you mean. You think it's just taking time out to do frivolous things on the side which have no bearing on the main mission of Hapanwo. Well, as I explained in this video, you can find Hapanwo-y things anywhere. And there are things that I look into which most other people think within our community think, well, why is that relevant? I mean, the guided buses video, people were saying, what's this got to do with conspiracies? And I explain in the video exactly why it is related to conspiracies. Okay, so that's why, and I did feel the urge to go and see the Viceroy's house, and I did. And I explained, I don't know why it was, but when I went there, as I'll explain in a minute, there are elements to the film which I think I should comment on. Mark goes on. Now, Ben, at present, things seem quite rosy in parapsychology. For example, Phenomena Project and Don Phillips is something very, very, very special. So why not focus on this more? I mean, we've all been waiting for something like this for so long, and now that we've found it, we should all be talking more about it and hypothesizing, etc. I defo thought you, of all people, would have made more fuss. I know you've interviewed Don in the past and Steve Mehrer, but I'd like to hear your take on it and your personal explanations of what you think might be going on. Maybe you could also get a little group discussion going on it at all. Just an idea. Now, I am in touch with Don and Steve, and I know, I'm familiar with their work. I spoke to Steve at the weekend at Probe. It is very, very, very special indeed what they're doing. I'm in touch with Don Phillips about doing like another video project about that in the next couple of weeks, incidentally. And I'm very, very keen on this. Now, what Don and Steve do, especially with the Bothell case, that in particular was extremely significant. That's the one they did in the United States. The evidence is indisputable. I mean, Steve is quite a taskmaster when it comes to things like that. He does play skeptic's advocate very well indeed. And so you're absolutely right, Mark. This is extremely significant, and I will be addressing it. But this doesn't mean I have to do that instead of the film reviews. I can do that and the film reviews, especially when I think the film reviews are significant. Mark goes on. I did think more people would be making a fuss about PP. What's PP? Peter Padgett. I don't know. A parapsychology phenomena. Oh, Phenomena Project. Yeah. Instead, like most YouTubers, have just reverted back to old discussions and old cases and old conspiracies, which is a pity as they are going over old ground for the umpteenth time. Well, as I said, Mark, as I said to you before, I believe I can do both, and I am very keen on the Phenomena Project and what they're doing. He goes on, and I would highly recommend you do a video on the simulation hypothesis at one time, because this particular hypothesis doesn't seem to explain so much. What is the simulation hypothesis? Sorry, Mark. Could you explain? Thanks. Right. Davit 11. Here we go. This is simple answer. Stop consuming MPAARIAA content. Maybe then you'll discover the plethora of independent artists who are struggling to have their work seen and actually enrich your life. I can promise you will not miss exploding cars and people surrounded, suspended by wires, doing somersaults and pretending to be heroes. I gave up consuming their crap when they started suing retired grandmothers because someone downloaded an MP3 using her Wi-Fi address. All right, so Dave, this is, or Davit, they're a bit. You're saying that these mainstream studios are like this. They do this habitually. So that's interesting. Now, as far as this particular film goes, I don't want to give you any. I'll be telling you all about the Viceroy's house in a minute, but there are no exploding cars in it, there are no people suspended by wires, and no one doing somersaults outside of some unusual yoga class. As for pretending to be heroes, well, I'll say a bit more about that as well. So, I mean, as I said, it's similar to Mark's point. He thinks I should not address this and address something else. Okay, well, I'll do both. I'll address things which I believe are significant. And I mean, now I've actually gone down this road and I've done something related to this, why shouldn't I go through with it? I've already had the urge to go and see the film. I've paid money. I've gone and seen the film. I've shot the movie that I was going to make. I've shot all the parts of the movie I was going to make. I'm going to upload it again. If you're watching this, it means I have uploaded it again. Kevin Wafer, he says, it's difficult running a channel and trying to avoid all these kinds of stuff. Keep up the good work, Ben. Thanks, Kevin. It certainly is. In fact, and this kind of thing, I mean, I've dealt with this before. I think I was pretty toughened up, actually, by the Colonel Holt incident. But this kind of thing can really freak people out because they're threatened. I mean, several times you're threatened with having your channel deleted. And some people put a massive amount of work into their YouTube channels. I do. These are major artistic creations that people which people build in association with the YouTube platform. And to have that, the threat that they would take that away for a movie trailer is just... It's an extremely malicious thing to do. It really is. One moment. Sorry about that, where was I? Yeah, basically, I mean, is it... Some people disagree with you on this, will disagree with me on this, but I think that social media in general is becoming less and less user-friendly. And these kinds of obstacles that YouTube are putting in your path is actually debilitating to the mission of content creators. And they need to sort it out. I mean, they've made progress in the sense that, despite what FCL said, this is an identical situation. FCL said that the reason they actually didn't strike my account and left the video up but blocked was so that the owner can view it to see if they want to go further. Well, I'm not sure that's the case. I think the situation is identical to the one really in 2015. In 2015, the Colonel Holt video involved my filming a live show in an official capacity, and one of the speakers, aware at the time that I was doing so and content with me doing so, then later changed their mind and said they didn't want to. In fact, they then put a strike out they then flagged my account for breach of copyright. This is exactly the same. I mean, this was just the year before, but I did the Dr. Jonathan Reed video as capacity of official filmmaker of a live lecture, which then has now been flagged for copyright because of the content of the lecture. When in accordance with Section 58, as I said, they can't do that. FCL also says, look what happened to your hospital job. Well, I know, but is that connected to this? So going back to Kevin Wafer, I mean, this is an improvement of the fact that my account hasn't been debilitated with a stupid warning strike. You know, which, as you know from 2015, meant that basically my account was basically disabled or rendered almost useless, because somebody decided that they wanted to put out a copyright attack against me, which YouTube immediately sustained. I then had to dox myself and put myself in a position where this person could take legal action against me in order to get my account restored. And I suppose YouTube are in a position where they have to do that in a way, because their position basically is they will honour any claim, but then to file a motion against it, you essentially become independent from YouTube. YouTube then wash their hands of it. You have to give your address to the person, so you're in a position where they take independent legal action against you, and YouTube are basically washing their hands of it. But they need to do more. I think they perhaps need to. Maybe there's some way they could change their policy. I don't know, and that's perhaps what James Coxwell wants to talk about. I don't know. Now, Sam B says, I often get these stupid copyright problems on my fairground and theme park videos when I upload them to YouTube, all because there was music in the background where I was filming, which I have no control over, so I have to dispute these copyright claims by putting that the content is now in the public domain and typing the explanation, filmed in a public place, which under UK law, it meets the criteria of UK law, so the claim isn't valid. If you ask me, YouTube should get rid of their content ID system because it's annoying, and also when these music companies put that their claim is still valid after reviewing the dispute, I bet you that it's automated and they don't look at it at all. Yeah, it is automated, Sam. I think it's the automated systems are actually what first detects these, and maybe they need to be looked into and made better. Now, surely, you know, if you take a rock video of the music you're playing, the music that's played on the fairground ride, if you were to take the video and then upload it to your own channel, especially if you monetize it, that would be a legitimate breach of copyright, and the copyright owner would have a legitimate claim against you. But in a sense, this is an inadvertence. You say filmed in a public place, and I'm glad that you UK copyright law, if it's met that, then I'm glad. I'm glad it is. This must be a kind of part of the fair use provisions. I wasn't aware of that, actually, because I was talking to someone who makes TV shows. Excuse me, man, I've got a little problem here. Come on, out you go. Out you go. Come on, come here. There's a ladybird stuck inside my window. Go on, out you go. Out you go. Go on. There. Sorry, I was Oh, there was a ladybird stuck inside my window and I was just letting her out. I don't know how it got there. Anyway, yeah, I mean, really, it's the content ID system should be sophisticated enough to tell the difference between a rock video and someone walking through a fairground and picking up a snatch of music. Surely that is within the parameters of YouTube's sort of algorithms. So they need to do that, need to start employing that. Lee Cook says, fucking hell, Ben, you must be creating some pretty offensive content if your videos are getting blocked throughout the entire Milky Way and beyond. That's right. Was it 496 countries? People could. Was it 596 countries? I know I had a call from someone in Zeta Reticuli saying they couldn't watch my video. Well, it's funny you should say this, but people are. People are having situations where, I mean, YouTube. And as I said, the person to look at is Dave Cullen, Computing Forever. He's looked into this enormously because this has actually affected him very much. He puts a lot of stuff up against SJWs and things like that, and political correctness, and other forms of cultural Marxism. He makes videos criticising that. And YouTube have found all kinds of different ways of knocking him down. I mean, he's getting half the viewing figures he ought to be getting. His viewing figures are greatly reduced. And all the YouTube users who address this point are, they're having their viewing figures dropped, people are being unsubscribed from them automatically, which is a really strange thing to do, and stuff like that. And now there's the age restriction filter. If you activate the age restriction filter, you can't see any of Dave's videos. They're all, the channel is just blank. And of course, YouTube now have like TV channels now where you can actually watch YouTube through television. I've done that myself. When you do that, I mean, you sometimes age restriction is automatically engaged when you switch on the television. Now, it doesn't seem to happen on my TV, although I don't watch my TV very much because most of it's rubbish and the rest of the people who live here watch it. But I was watching it the other day and I looked at my own channel, I could see it. So it's not affecting my channel. Also, I could see Dave's channels, the Computing Forever and Dave Cullen Show channels. So it seems that my own television, that's not a problem. But it's ways of bringing in censorship without saying you're bringing in censorship. You could say things like, well, it's removing, we're just taking action to restrict the availability of fake news or, you know, racism, offensive content, and all these things, you know, things that, racism, sexism, etc., homophobia, all these other things, misogyny. You know, they can say we're taking action against that. There's all kinds of different excuses they can make to say that to actually commit censorship when they're not, and say they're not committing censorship. We still believe in free speech. Sure, we're creating more loopholes for you, more hoops for you to jump through to get to your free speech, but you will still get there in the end. But the thing is, eventually the hoops, they'll just put so many hoops, so many restrictions, so many obstructions in the way of content creators that people just say, well, getting this free speech is just too much effort. Let's not bother. And it doesn't affect other people. It only affects some people. I mean, as I said, it's cultural Marxism. You could put up, there's a couple of Muslim hate preachers on YouTube. I don't think their videos are restricted. Things like that. You could put up videos saying how evil white heterosexual males are. No problem at all. Now, James Cox has left me a whole series of comments, actually. And I'm going to have to look through this. He said he started by saying this. Now, James Voluntarius Cox, I've actually been on his channel. If you go to his channel, I've done an interview with him. And he's left me some references here. He said, I'll start with his first comment. Don't use anybody's videos in your videos. There's no such thing as fair use, as a dispute for fair use will be settled in court. Copyright is BS. Now, I haven't looked in detail into what James has to say, because there's a massive amount of material on his channel relating to the copyright situations. I will have a look through that and see if, because perhaps I didn't understand James's point, because I replied to him and said, but look, there is a fair use situation here. There's fair use provisions in copyright. I gave the list of the various quotes here. And he said, but All that does not matter, Ben. If you use somebody's content, even if it's just a snippet, that person can put a claim against you. And if you dispute it, they do not take the claim strike away, you'll have to go to court, and the court, be it judge or jury, will decide whether it's fair use or not. Check out this video on my channel. And he talks about this Stephen Kinsella, an intellectual property attorney, talking about this. This video is called Where is the Fair Use with patent attorney Stephen Kinsella. So I'm going to have I will have to have a look through that. Now, there's several videos with this guy, Stephen Kinsella. And I've done a quick search. There's Stephen Kinsella debates. Stephen Kinsella debates. This is all on James's channel. Stephen Kinsella debates. And James has made his own response to Slax's videos, things like that. So this guy Stephen Kinsella, there's lots of videos with this guy Stephen Kinsella, who's some kind of lawyer. And I'll have to look through that, but I haven't looked through that yet, but I will. And thanks for the references. Okay. But I mean, as far as I can see, if you don't have, bearing in mind I haven't looked at what you've said, but if you don't have fair use provisions on copyright law, then this means that basically every single item in any form produced, if you take it to extreme, it's extreme, any item in any form produced by the copyright owner has to be individually licensed to everybody who interacts with it. And in such a situation, I don't see how it's possible. How is it possible to actually create film reviews if you don't provide some kind of reference material? And it's worse. I mean, it actually is the kind of fair use provisions. If you take away fair use provisions, the biggest damage that will be done is to the copyright owner itself, because, as I've said before, I've made the point before, it actually restricts the distribution of promotional material. Because it means that everyone who actually gets hold of a poster or trailer or anything else, or even any form of merchandise like a beer mat or something, cannot even distribute it without an individually licensed agreement with the copyright owner. And this is impossible. This would mean, basically, if, like I said, if the producers of the Viceroy movie, if they made a general rule. Universal, the rule they applied against me, then basically no one would, or far, far fewer people would be watching their film, because the trailer itself wouldn't be distributed as much. Supposing they said, well, IMDb doesn't have fair use on it, then IMDb wouldn't be able to play the trailer. Supposing they said Wikipedia, would Wikipedia be able to put a link to it? Things like that. There'd be only one platform with the trailer on, which would be like their website, and everyone else would only be able to link to it. They wouldn't be able to embed it, they wouldn't be able to upload it to their own platform or anything like that. This is a movie trailer that is intended to promote the film. If I have a movie and I put out a trailer, Sandra DeRoy, as I was speaking to Sandra DeRoy in a previous video, she put her trailer in the public domain. She said, just take it, upload it, download it, do what you like with it. It's a bloody trailer. The more people who see it, the better, because then the people will watch the film. That's the whole point of a trailer. I mean, talk about cutting off your nose to spite your face. As I said in my previous video, I'll put a link in the description box to my copyright, my More Copyright Trouble video. But I'll have a look at what this lawyer, Kinsella, has to say. Okay, I'll have a look at what this patent attorney, Stephen Kinsella, because I'm always looking for new information. And James has got a lot of good videos on his channel, including the one that I'm in. That's all the comments so far. Let's just see if any more have come in. I've got some more that have come in since I posted the notices. This is on the same thread with James. This is Stuss Page of Goo. Hi Ben, I have heard that if you mirror the image video you are using, it will be cool. I think you just have to change it significantly to get away with it. The person posting the Oak Island episode seemed to get away with it. Well, everybody gets away with it. I mean, I've seen multiple review videos, professional from professional media corporations and from independent YouTube users. and amateur filmmakers. They've done, a lot of them put up reviews. Some of them have entire review channels in which they don't only play the trailer, they play you clips, they play you long clips, and then they give their opinion of them. This is the point of fair use. I've kept the fair use slide up in the titles to this video, okay, because so that you know it, and it is the, as I said, it's the Copyright Design and Patents Act of 1988 and Section 17 of the U.S. Commercial Code 107. For the purposes of private study or research, for the purposes of criticism and review, free distribution, not for profit. My video, the previous version of this video, fulfills all those criteria, all of them. So the people, the producers of Viceroy had no cause to flag my video, none at all. And it's their loss, that's all I can say. Unfortunately, the rest of the... Okay, you're going to see... I'm going to show you the rest of the film now. Unfortunately, I made it before this happened. Otherwise, this probably would have biased me and I'd have given them a harsher review. So, anyway, please enjoy the rest of the film. Thank you very much.
I'm out of the cinema and it's still light. Can you believe it? It's actually still light. My goodness. I think this is because of... we're in spring now, I suppose. Well, the film was a bit strange, actually. It was slightly... It was not what I expected, but there was no... Nothing was there what I feared. I mean, there was no cultural Marxism in it. There's something I forgot to say at the beginning when it comes to bias in films. Let me just cross over. And I mean, I suppose, although I didn't want there to be any cultural Marxism in the film, at the same time, you know, I wouldn't want any propaganda leading for the other side. In other words, highly kind of right-wing, jingoistic propaganda. I mean, I wouldn't want that either, but then again, that's something you just never see nowadays. It's nowhere. I don't think it just doesn't work. You know, there was no sort of like, you know, the Brits weren't these sort of brave moustache twirling guys with monocles, you know, fighting off the evil fuzzy wuzzies. Now, this was different. I mean, this was actually a film that actually, this film, Viceroy's House, it was directed by an Indian woman who's the granddaughter of a survivor of the early days of independence, the chaotic days of independence and partition. Her grandmother died, actually. It says at the end of the film that her grandmother actually died during the Great Migration, the world's biggest migration in history, which took place when Pakistan was created. But this film didn't... This was a film without any real baggage. It just told a story. Now, the Indians... The director's name was it Gurinder Chandra or something like that? An Indian director. But this was not a Bollywood movie. No way. And by that, I mean think about the Bollywood films. The modern Bollywood films don't really stick to the style of the original style you get in the traditional Indian filmmaking methods. They tend to emulate Western templates. But this was not a Bollywood movie. It was all in English. I mean, even the Indian characters, when they were speaking amongst themselves, were speaking in English in their accents. They heard these accents speaking English. Some people think that's a bit tacky, and I can see why. But it was quite... it told the same story as you get, like in I said, in the last Viceroy. It's almost... I wouldn't say it's a remake, because it tells it from a different position from what I remember of that film. It's much more... It is similar to David Lean's Gandhi, which... covers part of this, told from the story of Gandhi. In this particular film, Gandhi is only a minor character. But it basically tells the story of the last days, the last Viceroy, and the independence of India through the eyes of the Viceroy and his family, his wife and daughter, but also from his staff, the people who work with him. And there's various different characters among the household. The most important of these is a young man called Jeet, who's a Hindu, who is in love with a woman called Alia, who works in the secretarial pool. He's a valet for the Viceroy, and she's in the secretarial pool. She's a Muslim, and there's a romance between them. And it's a kind of Romeo and Juliet-like love affair. You know, they're both from different sides and on the religious divides of India, but they love each other. And in the film, they do make the important point that India has always had an element of sort of ecumenical religious views. So, you know, it's not unusual in some areas for, or at least it wasn't, all throughout its history, for Muslim and Hindu families to join together. You know, there was in marriage, there wasn't always a division of sectarianism that you see in the situation, the political situation at the time and today. So Jeet and Ali are in love, but Jeet's going to be married to this Muslim guy. She's had a marriage arranged for her, and it's the old Romeo and Juliet style plot, you know. Boy meets girl, but girl's going to marry another boy, Mr. Wrong, so she can't have Mr. Right. And in the end, all goes out. You know, I won't spoil that for you. It's a film which is very well, it's very well sort of like coloured and everything. The film's, it's kind of like a, it almost has a kind of like a 1950s style Technicolor scheme to it in terms of the way it's presented, the colours. It's sort of like there's pastel shades everywhere and sort of bright reds and blues and things like that, on flags and banners and the uniforms. Everything's very clean. Everyone's very clean. I mean, the staff members and that, they look like the waiters and waitresses you get in curry houses, the way they're dressed. All the guys are clean shaven. The women don't have a hair out of place. Perhaps excessively so. I mean, there was a, because when Alia takes Jeet home to meet her father, who, a man he already knew, it's like the street they walk down is perfectly spotless, and everyone's dressed in the same immaculate saris that she is, which is inaccurate, really, which is not right, really. I mean, I know people have been to India, and they say it's quite a sort of messy place. There's a lot of dirt in the streets and things like that. I've never been there myself, but that's what they tell me, and I've seen that in pictures. So perhaps things later on, during the Civil War, you get a lot more injured people and mess in the street and things like that. But basically, I think it just wanted to tell that story. The film was just basically telling that story. It was very balanced, actually. It was very, there was very little kind of, I didn't detect any propaganda, any attempt to, you know, persuade the viewer of a political point of view. The British were very nice people, who, you know, Louis Mountbatten was a jolly, you know, nice chap who loved his family and also was very friendly with the servants and things like that. The Indians themselves were very proud and they were very, very civilised. You know, there was never any doubt that they could build a country. And it's now the what happened? You see, what happened with India? It all took place in the summer of 1947, which of course was when Roswell was going on. So all this was happening while Roswell was going on, and obviously this sort of stole the headlines a bit. But it is interesting. There is a pretty good conspiratorial element to this, which I should point out. See, Mountbatten is the Viceroy, but, you know, there's this sort of guy behind the scenes. I don't know if he's his assistant or what, but he's played by Michael Gambon. And what happens is, there's this guy that they decide in the end to go for a partition of India. Now what happens is, India under the British, of course, was a huge nation which encompasses all everything from, you know, the Khyber Pass to, you know, the Bay of Bengal. But there are a quarter of the people in that area were Muslim, and they decided, there's a guy called Jinnah who decided that after independence there should be a separate state for Muslims within British India, what was former British India. And so there was a lot of conflict. Some of the people on both sides agreed to it, others wanted something different. I mean, Gandhi was very opposed to any idea of the sort. He wanted India to remain whole. All of former British India, he wanted to remain whole. And Gandhi, I think, he wanted people to believe that he could create a state and everyone could be together, and the minority, the Muslim minority, would have nothing to fear. He wanted his people to share that vision. In other words, to do away with hatred. I mean, there's a scene in the film which Gandhi, who's very well played actually by an Indian actor. He says that all religions are true, and we must not let if you tear the heart apart, the heart won't function. God is never more outraged than when outrage is done in his name. This is a real quote from Gandhi. I'd heard it before. Gandhi, what he wanted to create an India which he believed was traditional. I mean, see, this is what Gandhi believed, and what some people say was exactly where the traditions of India lie. In that Muslims as a minority in a new Indian state wouldn't have anything to fear. Now maybe some of you will know more about this. So I know some of you may, some of my viewers actually are racially, have racial background, racial and national backgrounds within the Indian subcontinent, so you may know more of what I'm talking about. But so in a sense, he wanted to heal the divisions that already existed. And he believed that if you partition India, if you cut it up into two different parts, have a separate state for the Muslims, then it will just increase tension. And perhaps history has proven Gandhi right, because the actual civil war that broke out in 1947 and led to over 3 million people who were killed, I mean, entire villages, entire towns were burnt down by mobs. First one side would attack the other, then there'd be a retaliation. It was like Northern Ireland, only writ large. This is really still going on today. They're still fighting over Kashmir, which was never formally assigned to either side of the border. But only now they've got nuclear weapons. They've got nuclear missiles pointing at each other. So things have changed an awful lot in that respect. But, I mean, in the film Gandhi, you see these two lines of people walking in different directions. One's walking in one and the other, and then suddenly someone breaks out of one line, goes up and starts punching the others. And before you know it, they're all at it. There's a chain reaction. Before you know it, there's a massive riot. This did happen, and one side would chant, death to Hindus, death to Hindus. The other side, death to Muslims, death to Muslims. Is it inevitable that if you have people with different ideas living together, that this will happen? Is that inevitable? According to Gandhi, it wasn't. According to Gandhi, it hadn't been in the past. And he could heal the divisions that had grown up since then. And everyone could get along just fine. But the other guys, I'll tell you about the conspiratorial stuff in a minute, but Jinnah, this guy who created Pakistan, I mean, believed that they did have to have a separate state. And indeed, what happened was India was partitioned. What is now today Pakistan and Bangladesh was cut off from the rest of India. You know, former British India included all of what is today India, Pakistan, Bangladesh and Sri Lanka. And the minorities on either side of the border moved as quickly as they could to within the country that had been assigned to their religious denomination. And I suppose you do have to. It is potentially people can get along and have different ideas, as long as they don't displace each other, as long as they don't threaten each other. Or, and in some of these divisions, of course,
he's on
are
video.
Engineered. So it's just my fans there. You know, some of these divisions are engineered deliberately by the government, and I've talked about this before. This is why they're trying to do the same thing again here in Europe. I've talked about this before. This is why they're bringing hate preachers over from Saudi Arabia to preach in the mosques. This is why they're MI5 are putting their agents like Anjem Chowdhury, who's now not in jail, he's probably in some flat in Dubai. It's things like that. Divide and rule. And if someone makes that point, in fact, it's the character playing Pandit Nehru actually makes that point in the film. He says, oh, he goes to the Viceroy and says, you created this situation. I don't know if that's true or not. Whether the Raj did stir up religious tensions deliberately, I don't know if that's true or not. Now the conspiratorial angle, yeah. I told you there's something Hapanwo-esque in everything, didn't I? Yeah, Mountbatten discovers something alarming, like, because he's in the middle of deciding whether to go with Gandhi's idea and just try to heal the divisions and stop the civil war by appealing to everyone's better nature, or to go with Jinnah's idea and have a partition. He eventually opts, he goes back to London. He talks to people in Westminster. In the end, he decides to go with Jinnah, have partition. And he brings a guy played by Simon Callow to come over and arrange the borders where they can best be put, so that there is mostly Muslims on the Pakistani side, mostly Hindus on the Indian side, and Sikhs and things like that. The Sikhs were another group. I'll tell you more about the Sikhs in a minute. And eventually they decide to go with the partition. But then eventually, Michael Gambon's character, the psychic, the rather shady power behind the scenes, he's rather like a... He seems to play a similar role to Sir Humphrey Appleby in Yes Minister. He's the kind of rather crafty, devious, manipulative guy who's sort of sitting... He's not in charge, but he's controlling the man who's in charge. He reveals to Mountbatten through... Well, originally he just tells the border officer, but the border boundary designer, but then eventually it gets back to Mountbatten that there's a document, a highly classified document from 2 years earlier, i.e. from 1945, written up by Churchill when he was Prime Minister, which indicate that the British already had plans for Indian independence and for there to be a partition to create Pakistan and East Pakistan, what then became Bangladesh. And the border runs exactly where they all agreed it should run. And it's almost like, and you could see that this has already been decided in advance. And so Mountbatten is furious, and he goes up to the... And he challenges his assistant on this, Michael Gambon's character. But that just goes to show, doesn't it? You know, things... So it does delve into the area of conspiracy theory, and the idea that things do go on behind the scenes that people don't know about. Hmm. As far as the Sikhs go, I mean, like, the Sikhs, you see, were always... I mean, there was a Sikh... Funny enough, I was just listening to Red Ice earlier today. I had it on my earphones while I was at work. And they had this guy who was on Lana's show, the Radio 314. And this guy Singh, isn't he, called himself, which is a very common Sikh name. He was on there talking about it, and he was saying things like, he was very, very anti-Muslim, very opposed to Muslims, and saying, you know, that the Muslims are the worst thing that ever happened to India, etc., etc. But of course, and he said the British Empire was fantastic. He actually said the British Empire should never have ended. But then he also makes the point that, and this comes up in the film too, that the reason, the primary reason for Indian independence was that after the war, Britain just couldn't afford to keep India. Already the empire's fallen apart, and so India went independent. Now, the reason I bring this up is because I've come to believe that India actually was a pre-Illuminati culture, right up until maybe the 17th century. It wasn't the 18th century, it was the 17th century when the India Company took over. And really the British rule began. I actually do think it was a pre-Illuminati culture, because there's almost a continuous... I mean, I'll have to look some more into this, and I'm not certain, but there's almost a continuous... unbroken line of completely internally directed leaders, monarchs, dating back in all through its history. It's very, very long history. India is the oldest nation on earth. Its actual culture and its traditions stretch right back into prehistory. Its sacred texts, the Vedas, the Mahabharata, these are extremely old. They come from oral translations that were found in the Iron Age and the Bronze Age, and were only written down in the historical period. We're going on this bridge now. Ellis told me he used to climb up there when he was a kid. I'm not going to try that now. I do think India was a pre-Illuminati culture. Now this guy on Red Ice, he said an awful lot. Like he said Gandhi was a fool and stuff like this. Very opposed to Gandhi. He also said that something, and obviously there's always different sides to the story. But he's talking about the Mughal Empire now. He said the Mughal Empire was a terrible thing, that when the Mughals came in and took over India, this was basically a Persian family dynasty basically invaded and occupied India for a number of centuries. He said that during that time, they were Muslim, of course, and he said, well, during that time it was convert or die. You know, it's like the radical Islams today, like Islamists today, like ISIS or whatever. Now, if I watched Michael Wood's Legacy documentary from the 1990s, tells a very different story. Tells a story of the actual Mughal kings, that's Akbar the Great, the Mughal emperors, were very deeply influenced by traditional native Indian thought. And they actually tried to create a synthesis on political secular lines, to create a synthesis of the various cultures in India. Because, I mean, there was not just the Muslims, just things. It was like the Jains and the Buddhists and people like that, that were also in India. Buddhism originated in India. And he tried to create a secular state within his empire, which took into account all of those things. And he commissioned a translation of the Mahabharata into Persian. So this convert or die thing, I mean, this guy on Red Ice is either wrong or Michael Wood is wrong. There's no double think here. The two can't be the same. And so that's an interesting point of view from a Sikh. I mean, the Sikhs, like I said, there's a lot of conflict between the Sikhs and the Muslims. Maybe if you guys have actually come from that area, if anyone watching this has come from that area, you may know more about this. But it even translates into conflict, it even spills over within the communities here in Britain that originate from those areas. You know, there's been riots between Hindus and Muslims and Sikhs. I mean, the question I've asked her is, I mean, Gandhi, very famous, he slept through the night of the independence. The last scene has Gandhi sleeping on his mattress, just his mattress on his roof. He lived a very simple life. He didn't have a proper bed even, just a mattress on his roof. And he says, nothing important here, so he just went to sleep. Um, I mean, is that just human nature, or is it... Was Gandhi right? That's an important question. It's an interesting question. Because people inevitably come into conflict. I mean, conflict is unavoidable. It's one of the dialectics of the universe and life. But does it have to end up... Does it have to escalate to such tragic and violent levels? I think that was Gandhi's point. He wanted to try and heal that situation. And he saw the partition of India as a kind of surrender. As a surrender to sectarianism. So look, just separate, just cut the two of them apart from each other and leave them at that. Then we'll have peace. And of course, we haven't had peace. India and Pakistan, there's a cold war going on there. It's quite likely the nuclear war, if it breaks out anywhere, will probably break out there. So maybe Gandhi's been proven right by history. I mean, the film was all right. I did feel the urge to see it, and I'm glad I did. It was not bad. It's not bad at all. It's the start. I mean, I've got to say, like, the colours and stuff like that, and the cleanliness, and everything was neat. It was a bit Teletubbies-like. The way it was presented with all the blues and the reds and the yellows and all different colours and greens. And it was a very colourful film in terms of its style. You can even see that in the poster that you saw during the titles and in the trailer. So there was a lot of these very, very clever use of colour in the film. Everyone was very clean, like I said. Makeup perfect on the women. All the men cleanly shaved. Maybe, especially when they visit the poor areas, there perhaps should have been more dirt and destitution. Reminds me of this. Reminds me of the submarine stories I showed you on my shelf. One of them, I haven't got it anymore, by Alexander Fullerton, had a scene of a submarine in the South China Sea on board a junk. They just captured a junk, and the sailors were all in perfectly pressed white uniforms. They'd have been scruffy as hell with long, dirty beards. But then, I mean, maybe realism isn't the only factor in a movie. You know what I mean? I think this is a British or an American production, not an Indian production, but a lot of Indians were involved. Like, the director was an Indian woman, and there was lots of Indian people involved in its production, in writing it and producing it. So it's not a Bollywood movie, but it's had that Indian input. Okay. I'll probably think of some more to say, but I'm just going to go shopping, I'm going to go home, and then we'll see what the critics, those people have to say about it. I'm looking forward to this. Right, on to those lovely people, the critics, who are so wonderful, and I love them so much. Didn't mean what I said earlier. So, by the way, if you're not familiar with my film reviews, just to explain how it works, I will read out bits of the review in a rather strange voice. I read in the voice that I think are people who read these particular publications actually speak. There's two reasons why I do this. Firstly, it's because I interject my own commentary at certain points during what I read. Second reason, I like to take the piss. So let's start with the Garidian, that wonderful progressive news sheet, man. Yeah. Okay. The Viceroy's House's version of India's partition brings fake history to the screen. Imagine a film about the Holocaust where a character pulls open a drawer, pulls out a document and reveals that 6 million deaths aren't the fault of Hitler, but of Mussolini. Well, they have to lay the Holocaust guilt on us, don't they? They have to bring in the Holocaust. I talked about this in the film Denial. You want to make a white heterosexual male feel guilty? Just mention the Holocaust. They always do it, and the Guardian can be guaranteed to wheel out that old chestnut every single time. As if, you know, you're never gonna, nothing, it'll never be over. You know, everybody, even though the people who did it long ago, whatever they did,
they're long dead. Still, the white heterosexual males of the modern world are to blame for it. I bet at some point he's going to bring up slavery as well, isn't he? Anyway, I'll continue. Let's have a look. He talks about the basic outline of the plot. Apportioning blame has kept scholars in work for half a century. Was it the intransigence of the Indian National Congress and the All India Muslim League and their leaders, Jawaharlal Nehru and Muhammad Ali Jinnah? Was it the inevitable outcome of the imperial policy identified by its opponents of divide and rule? Did it flow from the politicisation of religious identity? How much of it can be put down to British haste, weakness and incompetence? How much did the characters of the last Viceroy and his wife play a part? And he goes into the basic background of the whole thing, of the whole business. Carries on basic little pieces like this. In an angry piece, Pakistani writer Fatima Bhutto accuses the British Indian director Gurinder Chadha of seeming to take pleasure in laying the bloodshed and brutality of 1947 at the feet of two particular villains, Muslims and Jinnah. It was, she wrote, a project of a deeply colonised imagination, servile pantomime of partition. You see, whenever they say colonised, that's it. They talk about colonised minds and things like that. That's cultural Marxism. That's cultural Marxism. Anyway, Chadha denies the charge of anti-Muslim prejudice, persuasively, I think. But to my mind, she and her fellow writers on the film and her American husband, Paul Maeda Burgess, and the English screenwriter Moira Buffini have committed just such as great a sin, which is to take breathtaking liberty with the historical record, man. Now, this is, I think, unfair from what I saw. I mean, maybe people who know more about this historically can answer it better, but it's never actually revealed what the cause of all the bloodshed was. Jinnah and the Viceroy, Mountbatten, are actually portrayed as people who are very, very upset by what has happened, by this terrible civil war that's broken out in India, and they are they're trying to stop it, and they disagree on the methods. But I mean Jinnah and Gandhi, of course, has a completely different view, as I explained. But I think it's very interesting that that Jinnah and Mountbatten believe their view, the full reason they bring in this partitioning is to prevent the violence. They want to try and break apart the two sides in the civil war by separating. Essentially, it's a segregation. It's similar to what you had in South Africa, where you have black and white people separated. They want to separate Muslim and Hindu. So I think that's unfair. Anyway, I continue. The film's Mussolini moment occurs when the unfortunate English lawyer who's been commissioned to draw the new boundaries, the sweating put upon Cyril Radcliffe, returns from the Punjab to Delhi to say it can't be done in a few weeks. He has at his disposal. It's all too complicated. And then, then it goes on to say that how Winston Churchill actually already had planned the partition of India several years earlier. And there's actually another piece of conspiratorial element that's briefly mentioned in the film, that the primary motive for which, and Michael Gambon's character, who's called Lord Ismay, actually explains, and this is important, I should have mentioned this earlier, actually explains that the primary concern is the Cold War, which had just started. Now, Pakistan acted as a piece of a separate state that could be controlled independently to India, which at the time was ruled by Nehru. He was going to be the first Prime Minister. Nehru was quite left-wing, and he was sympathetic to the Soviet Union. And I think they were, according to them, Churchill was concerned that the oil fields of Central Asia and the Middle East would be cut off from British control if Nehru was allowed to control everything up to the port of Karachi, because the port of Karachi on the coast of Pakistan is very, very important to the oil industry. It's one of the most important node in the oil industry, bullock. And it's possible that Nehru, with Soviets just hanging around, because the Soviets ended up invading Afghanistan, where there was there was a long, bitter war there. He was concerned that the Soviets would be getting a bit too close to Karachi. So there's another bit of interesting conspiratorial element there, anyway. Anyway, it goes in to talk about Manhattan. He feels angry about the whole thing. Manhattan, for whom this information has been concealed, feels angry and betrayed when he finds out. The film's clear implication is that when it comes to Britain's share of the blame for the bloodshed, Churchill, not Mountbatten, is the culprit. And he talks about a little bit about Churchill here, and it gives a little bit of extra history. Mountbatten's biographer, Philip Ziegler, said in his Spectator review, excuse me, that the original historians were wrong-headed, and it talks an awful lot about that in here. But, well, it's always the way with history. The Oxford historian, man, Faisal Devji, wrote that its appeal lay in the denial of any legitimacy and indeed integrity to the Pakistan movement by attributing it entirely to a British conspiracy and Muslim treachery. The film was unlikely to do well at the box office. Even so, it will attract a far larger audience than any book on Partition Man. And for so many people, it will be their only understanding of the subject. As with fake news, so with fake history. Oh, here we go. The fake news, fake history. Very, very witty, I'm sure. Very, very witty. Now, I don't know all about this. I don't know exactly why it's an issue that bothers them so much, or why this is somehow part of a controversy. This is clearly, this film represents part of a historical controversy within India's recent 20th century history. And no doubt there were other people who believe other things. But, it doesn't mean that it's wrong, just to put it this way. And the film, for me, seemed quite generous to all the characters. I mean, there were no real bad people in the film. There was no villain as such, apart from maybe Michael Gambon's character, Lord Ismay. He was kind of this conspirator operating behind the scenes. As I said, he reminded me of Sir Humphrey Appleby from Yes, Minister. So I think the director hasn't, shown any bias, and I think this partition brings fake history to the screen. Well, that's debatable. I'm sure scholars of Indian history could debate it. But as I said, the film itself, I think, was quite freshly done. Jinnah was not portrayed as a monster. Neither was Gandhi. Neither was Mountbatten. And Mountbatten was actually portrayed as a nice guy who didn't want anything to do with this conspiracy. Maybe that was true. But, I mean, The Guardian's not a source I trust that's particularly sensitive and particularly open to other ideas. As I said, I've said before, it's very biased. The reviews from The Guardian tend to be the worst of all. It's just like that's why I like to get them out of the way with first. So let's move on to the other reviews. Okay, let's see what the good old Telegraph has to say. Cornerstone of the British establishment. What's it think about this film about losing the jewel in the crown? Well, the Viceroy's House reviewed. Gurinder Chandra channels her inner David Lean. Director Gurinder Chandra, British Indian director, wasn't born when the supposed peaceful transfer of power from Britain to India took place in 1947. But the ensuing horrors of the partition engulfed her Sikh relatives and swept them up to devastation. One of her aunts was a mere child who starved to death. 14 million Hindus, Sikhs, Muslims were displaced. How to dramatise being caught in the midst of all this? Best known for crowd-pleasing comedies such as the genuinely sparky Bend It Like Beckham, Chadha has been absent from our screen since her 2010 DM Ealing farce, It's a Wonderful Life. She has upped her game massively for Viceroy's House, which revisits the build-up to partition and engages in a serious-minded way with the mess it made of so many lives. So credit where it's due. This is easily Chadha's most ambitious film to date, and her best for a long time. The access point for a British audience is downtown-esque. Dave, they've compared it to Downton Abbey again. Yeah, you've got to. Yeah. It's the upstairs downstairs intrigue in the grand New Delhi residence that housed India's last viceroys, up to the final man given the post by George VI, Lord Dicky Mountbatten. Hugh Bonneville plays this glamorous minor royal, fresh off the plane as the film is starting, with a dashing variation of his usual stiff upper lip, and he determined to keep India united under his watch. Now, the upstairs-downstairs thing is a good observation, actually, because it is a drama concerning the various people within staff as well. I mean, the romance, as I said, the main central love story is between Jeet and Alia, a Hindu man and a Muslim woman who were both on the staff, as I explained, of the Viceroy. I should actually point out, this is, in that sense, it's a very Indian film, as the director is a British Indian, as we've said. And I said it's a British production. I said American earlier on, that was on IMDb, which is wrong. It's nothing, the Americans weren't involved in it, it's just a British Indian production. But it's filmed mostly in India. But it's interesting that the actual script, the way it's scripted, the way it works, the love story between those two people, that subplot, is very Indian. I mean, it's exactly out what you get in a Bollywood movie. And of course, Bollywood films, if you ever watch a Bollywood films, there's always some kind of star-crossed love story, some piece of romance which varies in quality, but it's usually about two people. There's usually some pain and torment within the relationship. That's very common. Anyway, the critic continues. As Edwina Mountbatten, Gillian Anderson has come up with a curious stiff walk to match her necessarily strangulated accent. I think Gillian Anderson, her accent is sort of like very, she talks like this, she's very posh English. Now, Gillian Anderson is Irish, I think. She's got a good American accent when she's doing, when she's Scully. It's interesting, there was over 500 characters, like in terms of the various staff in the palace. You see a big photo of them in the poster. While sometimes a fraction too squawky, this is an intelligent and lively take on a tricky role. Edwina's notorious promiscuity is nowhere to be seen. You'll have to wait for another film, say, to fill in on her intense friendship with Jawaharlal Nehru. Excellent, Tanveer Ghani. That's the guy who played Nehru, who was good, yeah. There's only so much this desperately involved historical saga that Chader and her screenwriters are able to grapple with, of course. Supporting roles from Michael Gambon as Dickie's wily chief of staff and Simon Callow, the boundary commissioner. The focus isn't always judicious. Oh, yeah. So, what's interesting about this... particular critique? It doesn't focus on the political issues as much as The Guardian. It's more on the actual entertainment value, I suppose. Chadha has saved a big chunk of her budget for the very end, which must convey the chaos, scale and bloodshed of this mismanaged upheaval while knitting the story threads together. Finally, the Jeet Alia story pays off because Chadha channels her inner David Lean with a full-blooded matinee shamelessness that takes you aback. It is moving, actually, at the end, because towards the end there is the conclusion of the love story of between Jeet and Alia, and it is very well done. It reminds me a little bit of the end of Crocodile Dundee. If you remember the last scene in Crocodile Dundee in the subway station, where the crowds are so thick that no one could get through, and Mick Dundee is shouting for his lover, saying he's going to leave. He doesn't want her to leave. She's shouting to him. Sorry, he's about to leave, and she's shouting to him. And people are passing on the message. It's a wonderfully funny, wonderfully touching scene at the end of that brilliant film. And the end of without spoiling it by giving you the details, the end of the Viceroy's house is similar in that respect, where Alia and Jeet finally are reunited. So out there was The Telegraph. Right, I couldn't find a review in the Metro. I'll do this one instead. I'll do Well, this is Hollywood News. The Hollywood News. All right, how do Hollywood people speak? They kind of speak like this, don't they? Viceroy's House Review. Director Gurinder Chadha, 2017. Gurinder Chadha co-writes and directs this massively intimate and indeed epic story at the time of partition and independence in 1947 India. I sound like Morgan Freeman now. Anyway, Bended Like Beckham and Angus, Thongs and Perfect Snogging director, Gurinder Chadha brings Viceroy's House, her most personal and ambitious project, to cinema screens. A film debuting out of competition at the 2017 Berlin Film Festival, where it received its world premiere. The film is the true story of the 1947 handing over of power of India to the British Empire. It goes up just with the... It just goes on with the basic plot. As mentioned above, the scope of this movie is epic, but Chadha's film, which she co-wrote with her husband and frequent collaborator Paul Maida Burgess, is a very intimate one, with the heart of the story focusing on a young Hindu servant, Jeet, and his Muslim bride, Alia. A lot of Chadha's self-referential family history clearly influences some of this story arc, which involves the great Om Puri, Alia's father, who must abandon his home and leave for a new life, hundreds of miles from Delhi. So this person quite likes it. He said, they're exceptional, the latter, in one of his final roles before his sad passing in January 2017. I think that's, Alia's father, who is someone called Om Puri, he seems to be quite a well-known actor, veteran actor. He died in January, which is a shame. Hugh Bonneville stars firm as the central character of Mountbatten, while Gillian Anderson is also solid as Lady Edwina. The other cast provide a utterly convincing portrayal, including Niraj Kabi, who is Mahatma Gandhi. Well, he was good, actually. The actor playing Gandhi was pretty good, I thought. While one cannot fail to be impressed by the scale and execution of Chadha's film, it's difficult to overlook other less breathtaking elements along the way. While the practical locations, shot in Jodhpur in Rajasthan, are stunning, and the use of extras over computer-generated enhancements welcome, the film is slightly let down by scenes where its actors are imposed into old movie-tone reels, which you can't help feel were best left out together. No, I don't think that's fair. No, I don't think that's fair at all. It's really quite good because they have, like, they do put in old newsreels of which were really there, and some of them are real movie newsreels from the time. Some of them are new recreations for the film. Some of them are a mixture, and you actually have, like, the actors in the newsreels with people like Winston Churchill. You actually have see Hugh Bonneville with Winston Churchill in the film. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Some story arcs bleed into excessive sentimentality along the way, including right at the end, which was a slight disappointment. Well, again, that's this is on the order an American would be criticizing a British filmmaker about excessive sentimentality. That's a laugh coming from a Yank. Anyway, I mean, I quite like the ending. The ending was very moving. As I said, it resembles the last scene of Crocodile Dundee. And I liked it. I thought it was very well done. It was really, it was tense. Suspense. Will they? Won't they? You know, the last scene. Will they come back together? Will they not? Things like that. I think that's quite good. I mean, it was a bit of a. It was slightly Deus Ex Machina, I must say. But still, I thought it was all right. So generally, I'd say this was. It was not a bad film. And again, I'm not sure why I decided to go and see it, really. It was kind of... As I say, it's not particularly conspiratorial, but there were conspiratorial elements. And I think the... Especially sort of Cold War ploy and the use of the secret documents and things like that. I thought that was a neat little Hapanua-esque touch. So I'm glad I saw that. As I said, I think India was a pre-Illuminati civilization. Now, this doesn't mean it's perfect, but then I've never said that no Illuminati equals paradise. I mean, there were things in India that, me from my Western upbringing, I find appalling. Things like the caste system, the sati, the way that the traditional funeral for a man, in which the widow of the man deceased will sit on the funeral pyre and allow herself to be burned to death with him. This comes up in MMK's Passage to India, very famously. There's all kinds of things that are wrong with India, which could be improved about India. But this doesn't mean it doesn't have a right to exist. It doesn't mean that, therefore, the only solution is destruction. And I think, as I said, the British Empire wasn't embryonic, was intended to be an embryonic New World Order. And indeed, Cecil Rhodes, as I've spoken about in previous videos, actually wanted a New World Order based on the British Empire. It wasn't quite the monster that the left are claiming it was in. And one of the things I did like about this film was its lack. It resisted the temptation of diving into, you know, trendy progressivism and things like that. In a sense, I quite like the fact that the men and women played traditional male and female roles, which again is common in India, in Indian films and Indian culture. You know, there was no feminism. There was no, unlike with Resident Evil, there was no, Alia was not some really pushy, very bossy, very abusive woman who was constantly putting G down or hitting him or bossing him around, telling him what to do and humiliating him. I like that about it. So, all in all, I'd say, you know, 6 out of 10, 7 out of 10. It's not a bad film. Worth seeing. Nothing to shout about, but not bad either. And I enjoyed it. I'm glad I went to see it. So thank you very much for you've stuck with me through this slightly different review to my normal output. Hospital Port, it's Pride and Dignity. Stop the New World Order.